So welcome to Data Day. I'm personally very excited about this meeting. I'd like to think that it was because of my persistent nagging with PSR. Actually, didn't take nagging, but they were very accommodating. Recently, I'd sent an email asking that maybe it'd be great for PSRC staff to highlight some of the great data products that are available at this point in time, and that they've been very accommodating in that respect, and that we have them making presentations. So today we'll have several staff members from the data department hosting a presentation and conversation on various data products available for use by agencies across the Puget Sound. The four different data products that we'll be highlighting, including the data portal, census data products, model development, household travel survey. So we're going to have Craig Hellman now to kick us off and present those various products. Thanks so much, Craig.
Of course, Jesse, and thank you. This was Jesse's idea to do Data Day. We thought it was a great idea, and also to not have me talk, but to actually have the people who know what they're talking about talk to you all. And so you'll get a chance to hear from Lauren and Eric and Stefan and Brian. So I just wanted to kick this off with, some of you might not know, this is our website. We launched a new version of it in August. If you want to get to the data page, we're under Our Work. So if you go to Our Work and Data, you'll find our data page. So if you're looking under Planning or other places, you won't find us. Make sure you go to Our Work for Data. And then you can see some of the things, and I can click just on, say, example. Lauren is going to talk to you about the data portal. This is one of the most exciting things, I think, for us. It's built off of Esri's products. You've probably all sort of used Arc Online stuff, but you can see and just look and see all the different kind of data that you can get to. And so just wanted to kick it off, let you know, check out our data page. You can go in and find all kinds of interesting things there. And with that, I will turn it over to Lauren. I can stop sharing first to go ahead and share with you about our data portal project.
All right. Thanks, Craig. Let me figure out screen sharing here. Okay. Is this working out? All right. So I'm Lauren Engel. I'm a GIS analyst here at PSRC, and can tell you about our exciting new data portal. So the data portal is
Lauren, you're not sharing yours.
Oh, geez. Okay. Sorry. Thank you. What am I doing? I think I didn't share screen. Oh, I didn't click the share button. Now, there can you go. See it? Okay. Yep.
You're live.
Yay. Thank you. One more click I needed to make. So the data portal, Craig showed you how to get there, which is great. And a little sneak preview. It is our new location for all of the data that used to go to the data page on psrc.org. And we had a bunch of zip files that you could download and just kind of a list of things. This is built on Arc Online. So it gives us the option to really be able to see the data, to dig into it a bit more, get a lot more information before you decide that it's what you need. You can also, just interact with it a lot more than what you could on the previous way we had it set up on the website. All the data sets that were there before are still there, plus more. If you're looking for census boundaries, ACS data, transportation layers, regional geographies, any of that, it's all available on the data portal. We've got all the different formats. We've got even just our kind of standard PDF maps of the regional overview and things like that available on there. And then another cool thing is that you can download the data in lots of different formats to, you know, for whatever purposes you need. So I'm going to walk you through what some of that looks like. So yeah, Craig, as he showed you on our new website, how to get to the data portal. We've got this data portal icon. There's data throughout different parts of the website that are linked to the data portal. So if you're looking for household travel survey or something on that page, there will be links directly to that household travel survey data in the portal. So try to get it nicely integrated. You can also, of course, just Google the data portal. And in the slideshow that I think you guys will have access to, there's the direct link to the portal. So you got into the portal and this is what you see. You've got on this view to the right, you've got all the data by categories. So you click on, say, equity, and it'll just give you that subset of what's available on there. That's equity-focused data set. There's also some options to just like search the entire catalog. If you know, just have some ideas about what you're looking for, go right to that. When you click on the icon or do a search, you'll see this list of the data sets. It'll give you just like a little bit more information about what the data set is, when it was updated, what type of data set it is. And from there, click on one of these guys and the world of data is just opening up to you in these beautiful visual ways. So if it's spatial data, it'll open up to be a map. And one of the great things about this, you can click on the map. If this was live, you could click on one of these regional growth centers and get some information about it. You can draw on the map with some of these little squiggles and like select different things. You've got a little bit more information about what the data set is about, and then all these other options for things that you can do with the data. So yeah, and then also you can view the data as a table. Switch from the map view to the table view and see all the underlying data. If it's already tabular data, it's just going to show up as a table. For either type of data set, you can click on this filter icon and filter by any of the attribute data. So if you just wanted to select certain of the regional growth centers, you can do that. If you wanted to narrow some data down to a particular city or a time period or whatever it is, you can really like dig into the data in this way to get at just exactly what you want. All right, and then from there, you can download the data. So there's the little download data icon. It'll give you these options to download it in different formats. If you've used the filtering option before, you can toggle that on and off. If it's off, you'll get the entire data set. If it's on, you'll just get the piece that you're interested in. So that's a nice feature. And having them on here makes it really easy to make quick maps. We all love maps, right? Our planners, maps are great. So you can make a map without really needing to like open up ArcMap. You don't need to even really know anything about GIS. You can just get right into it. A lot of our layers they already have this symbology loaded into them. So this is an example of the regional geographies. It's all color-coded in the way that our standard maps are and vision and stuff like that. So if you go to the create a map and open it in the advanced mapping option, it's going to open up just like this. You can add other layers either from our data portal, from your own data, from any other place that has online web services. You can add that on and make your own map and change the symbols and do all sorts of great things with that. So that's really cool. Hopefully it'll make mapping and this kind of data exploration a lot more accessible to more people. And within in this little list of choices here, you can also see you can add the data to an Esri story map. You can connect the data through an API. And then there's some other options for kind of getting deeper into the metadata. And another great thing we've done with like building up the data portal is really like enhancing our metadata. It's a little spotty for some of the things beforehand, but we've, in going through and building this up, we've added a lot more metadata, and it's nice. You can get all the attribute information a bit more about like what the actual data is. So I think that is a really helpful part of this. So probably a lot of you have used a data portal like this before. It's like a fairly common format where, we're building it up on Esri's platform. So it's not anything like wild and new, but if you're unfamiliar or if it just something's not making sense, we've got this user's guide. You can just click on the user guide tab at the top of the data portal, and it'll kind of walk you through what the different pieces are and what you can do with it. And of course, if you have any questions about it, feel free to get in touch with us and ask. So we just launched the data portal over the summer with the launch of the new website. And we've got a lot of stuff in there. We've also got a lot of ideas of things we want to continue building into this. So currently, if you kind of scroll beneath where the data catalog is and all the icons, we've got this small selection of interactive maps and apps, and it's pretty much just what we have built using the Esri platform. They make it very easy to add in those pieces, a little bit more complicated to add in some of the tools that we've built in other ways. So we're working on getting those all loaded in there so that you can come to this data portal and find a wide range of the tools that we've built up in here. We're gonna create some custom mapping applications. I'm talking about kind of one with just some of the basic planning layers so that you can kind of put together a quick, easy map and see the connections between places and explore that. And like a census mapping application. So having all those, the different census layers and some of the data loaded into that and symbolized to make it really easy for people to just go in and find what they're looking for. And then also we're going to be continuing to add more data. So if there is anything that you're looking for, that you're interested in, that you're not finding on here, let us know and we'll work on getting that in there. And that is it. If you have any questions, I don't know if we're doing questions right now or later, but feel free to get in touch with me or anyone at PSRC really about this.
Craig, how would you prefer to take questions? Do you want to wait till after everyone's done in your
no.
batting lineup or now?
Okay. No, go if you have questions for Lauren specifically now, go ahead and ask.
So are there any questions from the group? So Lauren, you've opened up a big door when you say that if anyone has questions as to how they use this stuff to see you, is it you specifically that they should be calling? Is that correct?
Probably, yeah. I mean, okay. I was, you know, kind of leading this project and have them know all the ins and outs. So I can definitely guide you through. I'm sure there are other people that could answer a lot of questions, but yeah, I'm happy to field any questions about it now or later.
So I see this as a fantastic resource for people who are doing their comp plan updates, and that provides people the information to, as background as far as the statistics in their analysis and the comp plan planning. How difficult is it to be able to, from a score of 1 to 10 for the basic planner, from what you know of them, to be able to actually use this website and get into the data map and create, I guess, products that they could insert into their plan?
That's a hard question for me to answer because I have been doing GIS for a long time. So a lot of this stuff is very kind of intuitive at this point. But I think it definitely makes it pretty easy. I mean, like I said, you really can just click on create a map and it will make a very basic map for you. And it's very easy to add additional layers. I think the interface that Esri's created for ARC Online does really kind of guide you through without needing to know as much kind of technical detail from that kind of like GIS perspective. And hopefully us like having some of the data already symbolized in there will make it so that you're not really having to think too much about the cartographic design and stuff like that. You can just make something that will, you know, hopefully look good and work for what you're doing.
And I did peek into this actual portal, and I noticed that for census information, it got down to track and was there block level also data?
So I mean, we've got as far as like the GIS data, we've got block group tracked. Right. We've got tables for ACS data. We've got, you know, some different kind of demographic layers. So we've got a variety of census data in there.
Okay. Thank you so much. I don't see any other questions. So thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Lauren. And Jesse, I would say, not being a non-GIS person, I'd put it on a scale of 3 or 4. It's really intuitive. What I really like about it is you can get to the data, and as Lauren was showing you can filter to what you want. So you're not always stuck with just the regional data set. If you want something specific to Pierce County, you can go in there, you can get it, and then you can download it into whatever format you want. That's the other nice thing. It gets it a lot easier for you to get it in different formats. So I think even an engineer like myself, who doesn't really know GIS well, can actually get to the data and use it pretty easily. So hope everyone experiments with it. I think it's light years beyond what we've had on our website before. So I'm very excited with all the work Lauren put into getting it out there. And it wasn't just Lauren, there's lots of other people at PSRC who are part of it, but Lauren was the leader that got us there and brought all the vision together. So we're really excited about it. So play with it. Let us know as you use it, any other things that you might like to see in it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. All right. So next up, we have Eric to talk about the census data products.
Yes. Thank you, Craig. Get my screen shared here. Okay. Can everyone see my screen?
Yep.
Yep.
Sounds great. Well, hi, my name is Eric, a relatively new assistant planner here at PSRC, here to talk about census data, where to find it, and how to learn more. All right, today's conversation, I'd like to cover these four broad areas, starting with what kind of data products are out there released by the Census Bureau, how to access some of that data, caveats and limitations that come with these data, as well as the available resources, trainings, and webinars that you can use to learn more. All right, the Census Bureau is a very busy agency. They release over 130 data products a year. I'd say the most commonly used data in local planning are going to be the decennial census, as well as the American Community Survey, which I will refer to as the ACS from here on out. And I'm sure you're probably familiar with both. All right, the most recent decennial census was conducted in 2020. And so far they've released just the redistricting data, which is one small slice of the overall pie of data. And the redistricting data is used by states to redraw and redistrict their legislative boundaries and includes the, among other things, the blue variables I've listed here, race, ethnicity, voting age, and some information about housing. The redistricting data was released in September of last year, and we're hoping for the final version and all the other data to be released sometime in mid-2023. All right, you might be asking yourself, Eric, what is the difference between the decennial census and the ACS? I'd say the biggest thing to take away is that the decennial is an official count where the Bureau tries to hear from quite literally every person in the country, whereas the ACS is a survey. They still reach, I think it's 3 million people every year, which is quite the survey, but it's not everyone. As I just said, the ACS is conducted yearly, where the decennial is every 10 years. The ACS releases a one-year file every year, and then they also release a five-year file, which is just 5 years of survey results combined with some fancy math that gives you slightly better results than the 1 year. So yeah, got a few options there. All right, I won't go through all of these, but the ACS covers a lot of ground, much more ground than the decennial. The ones I wanted to point out here are bolded, like population, Hispanic origin, race, income, housing costs, as well as tenure, who owns and who rents. I am thinking that these would be useful with the comprehensive plan updates coming up soon. All right, the ACS releases a bunch of different types of tables, but the ones that I thought are most important for you to see or to know about would be firstly, the data profiles, which is a combination of the most frequently requested social, economic, housing, and demographic data. But if you'd like to dive deeper into a more complicated question, you can look at the subject or detailed tables. So the example I have here is poverty status within the last 12 months. That's a more complicated question to ask and wouldn't be found directly in the data profiles. You might be asking yourself, well, what if I can't find what I need? A couple recommendations would be to try different vintages of the ACS. So either the 1 year or the 5 year. I believe the 1 year vintage, the geography has to have more than 65,000 people in it for you to use the 1 year. So smaller jurisdictions will have to use the 5 year. If you are a larger jurisdiction though, you could consider using the PUMS data, the public use microdata sample, which is a mouthful, but essentially you can create your own custom tables, which is very cool. All right, census geographies. On the right here, you'll see a diagram, pretty basic, of all the geographies that are available, starting from the largest at the top to the smallest at the bottom. Obviously nation at the top, and goes all the way down to states, places, counties, tracts, block groups, and blocks. On the left, you'll find a table that displays which geographies are available through the ACS and the decennial. Since the decennial is a full count of every single person, every single household in the country, You can get data at all of those levels. The ACS is a little more limited. It goes down to the block group level. And I have some stars here on next to those yeses, because you may have to jump to a 5-year ACS to get data at those smaller levels. If you'd like to access the data, there are a bunch of ways to get there. One place I recommend looking is straight to the Census Bureau's website, data.census.gov. If you haven't gone looking for census data recently, they launched this new website, gosh, I think a couple years ago, but it's been improved a lot. It's really nice to work with. I also have a QR code here if you'd like to scan it with your phone and go to a page that describes more about this portal and how to use it. Of course, you could go to our website as well. We have a few sources, like Lauren just talked about earlier. We've got our data profile, data portal, sorry, as well as our community profiles portal, which is really awesome. It'll allow you to grab data for your specific jurisdiction, which is really helpful. All right. This wouldn't be a conversation about census data if we did not talk about data limitations and caveats. Three really big points I wanted to make here. Number one, the ACS being a survey, kind of like a political survey you hear about with the midterms coming up, there are margins of error, and those can come into play, especially for smaller geographies. The decennial census does not have a margin of error. The second thing would be the impact of the pandemic on data collection and reliability. The Census Bureau actually didn't release the 2020 one-year ACS due to the impacts of data collection during the pandemic. So that's something to note as you're looking into the data. And finally, I could give a long talk, and the Census Bureau could give an even longer talk about how differential privacy is going to affect the 2020 decennial census data. If you're unfamiliar, differential privacy is essentially a way of protecting the privacy of respondents to the decennial census. We're seeing some effects on smaller geographies, but we won't know more until we see all of the data, which, as I said before, will be released sometime in 2023. And finally, if you'd like to learn more, the Census Bureau has a bunch of resources, trainings, webinars. We've also had trainings as well through PSRC. Here, I have a QR code going to this website where you can find a document the Census Bureau has made specifically for local government users of the ACS, and they have a bunch of documentation that can be very useful. So I'd recommend checking that out as well. Awesome. Well, thank you. Happy to answer any questions.
Are there questions for Mr. Clue? Thank you very much for that presentation, by the way, Eric.
Of course.
Stunned silence here. Hey, so I have a question, Eric.
Yeah.
Why would one go to the ACS website when one could go to your handy dandy data portal? What is the difference?
I'll say the census website has every table imaginable. So you can get into a lot more detail. Our website includes the most common tables that you would need. So it's perhaps an easier way of getting it. But if you really want to dig down deep, the Census Bureau's website is the best place to go.
And just to let you know, I have gone to the ACS website to look for information. It is not that user-friendly compared to your data portal.
Yeah. I poke around in it a lot, so I have fewer challenges, but I've definitely heard that before.
So the other issue is, how would you recommend people handle the pandemic era, the data itself? If you're looking at looking at longitudinal data from 2000 to 2010, 2020, what's your recommendation of how jurisdictions are going to deal with that with regard to things that are pretty volatile in these times, like transportation data?
Yeah, that's a challenge. I think the first thing I can think of is there may not be data available yet post-pandemic or in this beyond 2020 period. We do have some ACS data available. The 1 year 2021 data was released a couple weeks ago. So I would recommend looking at pre and post trends to see what you can make out. It's hard because, you know, everyone wants an answer now, what happened yesterday, and the census data is lagging. So in a couple of years, we'll have a lot better data pre and post. Yeah, they release data every year. So the more they release, the more we can learn.
Excellent. So I have a question for PSRC staff, not related to this, but thank you very much, Eric, for the presentation. I don't see any other questions at this moment, unless someone else does. Ben, apparently at 10:20, we have an event. I guess it's the Great Shakeout. Is there any sense of as to how we observe this? Do we all go off screen at that time and go underneath our tables? Or how do you want to handle this?
Good question, Jesse. I have seen some messages that people will have to leave us at 10:20. I don't think we can, I'm in the office. I don't think many of our other staff are in the office, so we're not gonna be observing it officially.
Okay.
But maybe we'll at 10:20, we'll just acknowledge that maybe we'll see some folks leave us for a bit. But yes, the Great Shake, 10:20.
Well, you can flash the message in the chat just saying
that's what I'll 10, do. I'll put some appropriately shaky language in the chat.
as opposed to our typical shaky language. That's great. If you could do that, at least we can say that we recognize this as we are trying to practice safe working habits here, right?
And just so folks know, our presentations are always available. So some of you are going to miss Stefan. If you're out for the Great Shakeout, you'll miss hearing about our models, but the presentations are available. And I see in the upper corner, this thing's recorded. So I assume we make the recording available as well.
We are. And we've already received some requests for folks who are going to have to leave for precisely that reason. And so we'll be posting the recording, and we'll follow up this meeting with links for where we're gonna post it.
There is a question in the chat. If you folks note, do you have any response to that regarding safety? It's for Lauren or Ben on crash data.
It's not on the. I'd ask Craig probably to weigh in on crash data. One of the things you may be aware of is part of our regional transportation plan that was adopted in May. We do have an action item for us to develop a regional safety plan. The state of Washington collects and posts crash data and fatality data on a portal that they maintain. We'll be working with them to see how we can use that data as part of the development of a regional safety plan. We also, you may have heard, may or may not have heard, so you're probably aware that there was a notice of funding opportunity that had a deadline of September 15th for the Safe Streets for All program, which is a new federal grant program that was authorized under the IIJA, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, or BIL, also the bipartisan infrastructure law. We applied for a grant to develop a regional action plan as part of that program. We expect to hear from DOT about the award of grants. They're awarding $1 billion in grants around the country. We expect to hear probably early in the new year. We don't really, I think that's what the latest word is, late this year, early in the new year. And we'll be doing a lot more with safety data in the future. We don't really have a lot of it available through PSRC at this point. So Craig, anything to add on that about safety data?
I would just echo what you said. WASHDOT has a great data portal where you can get really detailed accident data. It's actually fairly current, point level, all kinds of attributes that go along with it. So for now, I definitely would recommend WASHDOT's site. It's actually really, really good in terms of the data that you can get, and the level that you can get it down to is pretty impressive.
Great. Thank you for that.
And the last thing I would add on the census, I just want to reiterate, Eric did a great job of describing that. And Jesse, your question about what's on our site versus not, why would you go to the census website? I too struggle on the census website because there is so much information there. So as Eric was mentioning, we've tried to take the greatest hits that we know people tend to like. That's what's on our website. But there will be topics that you'll be interested in that maybe aren't in those most frequently thing. I mean, there's gigabytes upon gigabytes of data on the census website, and we don't want to take all of their data and then store it on our servers as well. And so that's really probably the biggest difference. There you go. I see Ben shaking his... I like for a second, I'm like downtown Seattle having an earthquake. I'm not feeling it in Kenmore. So, perfect, Ben. I love it. So, yeah. So it is 10:20. So folks, we understand. If you need to head out,
please do. I was raised in California, so I have a long history of ducking and covering.
I remember waking up one morning in San Diego and my twin bed was like in the middle of the room because there was an earthquake in the middle of the night, and I don't even remember feeling it, but my bed moved. I was like, why is my bed in the middle of the room? So there you go.
Wow. That is wonderful, Ben. And Ben, I too have a history of ducking and covering in Philadelphia, which is not a seismic threat, but because it was gunfire.
we'll observe that a different day, Jesse.
Okay, yeah. Cool stuff. Okay. Great, right. Carry on.
Yeah, so I don't know how to follow that one, Jesse. So why don't we just throw it over to Stefan? So the next on our list, Stefan's going to talk about our model development program and specifically about Soundcast and the tools that are part of our activity-based travel demand model. We have lots of models, but his conversation is going to be focused on our travel model. So Stefan, turn it over to you.
Great, thanks. Let me get this all set up here. All right, first of all, can everybody hear me, or can someone tell me if they can hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Stefan.
All right, and you can see my presentation?
Yep.
Great. All right, so today, so first of all, an introduction. My name is Stefan Koh. I'm a principal travel modeler here at PSRC. And today we're gonna be talking about our travel demand model, Soundcast. Let's do just one thing here quickly, sorry. Here we go. Let me see if I can move this. Sorry. There we go. Good. So today I'm going to be talking about our travel demand model called Soundcast. And this presentation is kind of organized into two parts. I'll kind of give a high-level overview of Soundcast and how it works. And then I'm going to talk about some of our development efforts with an emphasis on ActivitySim and its future role in Soundcast. So we're just kind of coming out of, just finishing up our RCP last year, and we were doing a lot of model application for that process. And so now we're kind of entering into this next five-year cycle. Where at the beginning, we can kind of focus on some model improvements and development as we kind of get ready for that next RTP analysis. So what is Soundcast? Soundcast is PSRC's travel demand model that simulates individual people and their households. It predicts how they will conduct daily activities, where, when, and for how long. And it also predicts the travel choices that people make to complete those activities, such as the mode of transport to get from one activity to another. Soundcast allows us to evaluate the effect of transportation and land use policies on individual behavior. It allows us to look at a wide range of performance indicators at different levels of geographic aggregation. So for example, here we're looking just at this pie chart showing the mode distribution for residents of Lakewood. Some of the strengths of Soundcast, we can look at travel patterns in certain places, like I showed on the previous slide. So for, TOD areas or regional centers, for example, we can look at specific populations. We can look at mode choices. We can also look at pricing. So what impacts does tolling have on congestion, for example? So these are just a few examples, of how Soundcast can be used and sort of some of the things that we're able to use it for. Soundcast is a collection of models that cover households, trucks, external trips, and airport trips. We also have a bike model that takes slope and bicycle infrastructure into consideration. And I'm not exactly sure about this stat, but I think households generate roughly 80% of all trips, and maybe more. So you know, that's the biggest component of Soundcast, is the sort of household demand model. And that's covered by what we call an activity-based model. And our activity-based model right now is called DaySim, which is an open source project created by RSG. But later on in the presentation, I'm going to talk about ActivitySim, which will eventually replace sort of DaySim as the household demand model. So a little bit about Soundcast geography. Soundcast is parcel-based. So parcels are represented by the center or centroid of their polygon. And in the region, we have over 1 million parcels. So it's a lot of data. So we basically represent jobs and households at the parcel level, and trips occur in the model between one parcel to another. This high level of spatial resolution allows us to sort of aggregate model results to higher levels of geography so that we could show things at geographies that are important to planners, you know, such as cities or regional growth centers or within transit buffers, for example. So kind of going back to that first slide or second slide again, where we showed, you know, the mode choices or mode distribution for Lakewood residents. So Soundcast, so I just want to point out in this slide, like, the importance of our household survey and how it's relevant to Soundcast. And I think Brian and Suzanne are going to be talking about the household travel survey after me, but it's very important to our model. In fact, the model creates a simulated household travel diary for every person or household in the region. And so here in the slide on the left, I'm just showing some household survey locations from a previous household survey. So those are the locations of the households that, you know, responded to the survey. And then the slide on the right kind of shows where people are at some point during the day and what the activity level that they're doing at that point of the day. So again, we use data collected from the survey to inform how the model predicts travel behavior. And one of the key outputs of the model is sort of a list of trips that look exactly like a trip diary for each person that you would see sort of in the household survey. Activity-based models are sometimes or oftentimes known as tour-based models. And this sort of recognizes the fact that travel includes more than one destination. So tours are a way to sort of conceptually organize connected or chain trips. And tours in Soundcast are either home-based or work-based. And they include the stops that are taken along the way to a primary destination or on the way back to the tour origin. So for example, this graphic includes one tour with three intermediate stops, one on the way to work, which is the primary destination, and then two stops on the way back home. And so there's sort of five trips in total. So at the top left, we have, like, you know, this would be sort of an excerpt from our tour table, and it shows just one tour. And then the corresponding trips for that tour are listed on that sort of table to the right. And that includes important information about the trip, such as the tour that it comes from, but also things like, you know, the origin, destination, the mode, things like that. So I just want to talk a little bit about the model steps. In this graphic, the green rectangles are the steps covered by the activity-based model, which again is that sort of household demand model. So we start with household and persons, and then we use what are called choice models to decide the sort of what, where, when, and how in terms of activities and travel. So we'll start off with day pattern, and that kind of determines what activities people are going to do throughout the day. So are they going to go to work? Are they going to go to school? Are they going to go shopping? And then we determine how many tours they will do for each activity. and also what stops they might make along the way. The next step is destination choice, and this is where the locations of their primary destinations are picked, and then also where the stops are that they're going to do along the way to those primary destinations or on the way home. Then we do mode choice, and this is sort of, you know, determining which modes are going to take to complete these trips. So are they going to use car or bus or light rail or something like that? Sorry, one sec. So after, so the next step is time choice, and that determines when people are traveling. And then after that, we do route assignment, and that's sort of the next step after the activity-based model runs. So like I said, after the activity model has completed, one of the outputs is a detailed table of all simulated trips. So each record or row in this table on a slide includes detailed information about simulated trips, including departure time, arrival time, origin destination, trip purpose, the parent tour, and the mode. So when you look at the table and you see the field names up here, they're, you know, not super descriptive, but like, for example, this is the origin TAS, destination TAS, origin purpose, destination purpose. So just a lot of information about the trips that the model has generated throughout the simulation. So at this point in the model stream, we could say a lot about how people are traveling, such as their mode choice and their trip purpose and destination choice and travel time and distance. But we can't say anything specific about the routes these trips use to get from their origin to their destination. So the next step is to run these trips through a process called assignment or traffic assignment. And before we do that, we have to aggregate our trips up to zones called traffic analysis zones. And we do this because route assignment is computationally intensive. So it would be just impossible to do it at the parcel to parcel level. So again, we just aggregate these trips up to the zonal level and then go through the process of route assignment. And so this slide is all about route assignment. So assignment chooses the path for each trip that each trip takes to get from their origin to the destination. So think of it kind of how like you use Google Maps, you know, on your smartphone when you're trying to find the route to where you want to go. The procedure sort of iteratively assigns trips to the fastest route from their origin to the destination, and basically keeps doing this over and over again until changing a route or path will not decrease travel time. So it reaches a sort of equilibrium. The process considers the posted speed limits on each link or road segment, the capacity of that road, and the sort of volume delay function, which decreases speeds on a link as it approaches capacity. So as, you know, congestion starts to happen, the speed on each piece of network starts to decline. Once completed, a lot of data for each individual roadway or transit segment, such as volume and speed, sort of are available. So that kind of wraps up how the model works. And, you know, I know that was kind of a high level overview, but I'm just going to pause there really quickly to see if there are any questions about that sort of process. All right, hearing none, I'm gonna move on to talk about Activity Sim. And so Activity Sim is a collaborative effort to build a state-of-the-art activity-based model. PSRC has been involved in this consortium for almost from the start. I think we joined in the second year that it was in existence. And in Soundcast, again, I think I've said this before, but just kind of hammer the point home that Activity Sim will eventually replace our existing household demand model in Soundcast, which is called DaySim. So Activity Sim is a partnership with, and currently has 10 other MPOs collaborating. And it's been kind of growing pretty much every year. I think when this started about 10 or so years ago, there were two or three agencies involved. So it's gaining a lot of traction in the industry, and it seems poised to sort of become an industry standard relatively soon. And you don't have to be a member to use ActivitySim. It's all open source. But being a member of the consortium kind of gives you a seat at the table. So we've been really happy with being a partner in this group, and I think it's paid a lot of dividends. Some of the core principles that are driving ActivitySim include the project is sort of very collaborative in nature, and this is not just because it's open source, but because it's a group effort sort of by design. It's cost effective since we use pooled funding, and so the costs are spread across all the participating agencies. ActivitySim is practical. It's easy for new users to learn sort of the ins and outs of running the model. It's extensible, meaning that it can be customized and new features can be added without sort of breaking things. And it's also performant. It's fast and efficient, and it's got a good software platform. ActivitySim has a sort of codified governance structure, which includes the project management committee. The PMC is comprised of agency staff. So for example, I'm PSRC's representative on the PMC. And some of the responsibilities of the PMC include setting development priorities, providing technical direction and oversight, implementing best software development practices, identifying and developing new features to respond to new policy analysis needs. So like an example of this is, we have a new, relatively new telecommute model. And I think this is gonna be super important, in a post-COVID world, or hopefully at some point post-COVID world, or a new normal, to be able to, run scenarios of different telecommute, the amount of people that are telecommuting each day. So that's just kind of one of the examples of an improvement we've made. And then finally, the PMC goes through an annual scoping and budgeting process. ActivitySim's design is based on MTC's CTRAMP model. It was basically translated from Java to the ActivitySim platform, which is based on Python, sort of using best software development practices. The design of the code is modular, so it facilitates sort of extensibility. And the code is tested every time new changes are added, and the documentation is kept up to date very consistently. So I just want to talk a little bit about ActivitySim features. One of the nice features of ActivitySim is that the model specifications and parameters are sort of separated from the code. So it makes it a lot easier to make sort of customizations to the model without having to like change or alter the core code that's running the model. ActivitySim incorporates multi-processing. So it makes things run really fast and performant. It has this feature called pipelining, which means that the model kind of runs in these steps that can be started and stopped. And so, you can kind of resume a model at any point along the pipeline. And it also includes extensive tracing and logging, which is just really useful for debugging, basically tracing households and individual persons throughout the model and having detailed reports about what those households are doing in each step along the way. Just a little bit about the status of our ActivitySim. So up until 2018, most of the work was focused again, like on translating and implementing MTC's model into this framework. And so this really just included a lot of software development and also a lot of verification that, the new implementation, the results of the new implementation was sort of matching the results of the old implementation, just to make sure that all the work was done sort of correctly. Since 2018, most of the efforts have been spent to improve performance and implement new features and Some of these features include multi-processing, like I mentioned, estimation mode, support for TNCs, telecommute model, a vehicle type model, explicit school pickup and drop-off, better accessibility measures to support the destination choice models. So not an exhaustive list, but just some of the things that have happened over the last several years that I think are really important and exciting. And then now to talk a little bit about our own sort of process about implementing ActivitySim. So, you know, ActivitySim has had several stable releases, but we still need to implement it for our region. And so we've been kind of working on that over the past few years. And we're really kind of focused on getting ActivitySim to run with our data, getting familiar with the code base and sort of running the model. And along the way, sort of helping the consortium test performance and new features, and also testing what's called estimation mode, which is where we use sort of data from the household travel survey to estimate parameters for each model. In terms of current work, we're focusing sort of on customizing the model, model specifications for the Puget Sound, for the PSRC region. So for example, we want to make sure that the model represents sort of the various transit modes that are really important for the region. So, you know, most notably it would be include ferry, right? Some regions don't have ferry, so they wouldn't include that in their model, but also, you know, be able to explicitly represent light rail, commuter rail, BRT, and things like that. So that's just one example, but, and there's many others, but, you know, each region is different and we have our own sort of customizations to make the model relevant for the policy questions that we want to be able to ask. In addition to that, we're implementing testing new ActivitySim features and models, again, using the household travel survey to estimate model components. This again ensures that, you know, the model represents the travel behavior that is based on our region. And finally, kind of integrating ActivitySim into Soundcast so that the full model can kind of run seamlessly. So going forward, our goals are to move Soundcast from its current 2018 base year to a 2023 base year, estimate ActivitySim using the spring 2023 household travel survey. And I think we're kind of optimistic that this will represent, you know, a somewhat stable post peak pandemic conditions. I'm not going to go out and say we're at post-pandemic yet, but hopefully, you know, somewhat stable conditions and behavior will have been and will be emerging, you know, going into next spring, because we want to have that sort of represented in the base year of the model. Like, we don't want to have March of 2020, you know, as sort of the baseline behavior in the model, right? And we would also like to have ActivitySim in place for our next RTP. We do have a small, not small, but medium-sized support contract to help. We have not picked a consultant yet for this work. That'll be happening soon, but they'll be able to sort of help us along in this process and give us some technical support. So that kind of wraps up all my slides today. So I guess at this point, I can just go open it up for questions. Any questions?
Stefan, there's a question in the chat.
Oh, okay, great. Let's see here.
Do you want me to read it, Stefan, so you can, or do you see it?
Yeah, no, I can see it. Here, I can stop sharing, I think, right? So I'm wondering how recreation trips are handled in the Soundcast modeling process. Those trips that don't have a destination, rather, are out and back from to a residence or employment site. So we do model, you know, things like we do model recreation trips. And so those, you know, are going to places where sort of the attraction is represented by some level of employment. So we're probably not explicitly representing like hiking in the mountains and stuff like that, but you know, but they are included as a trip purpose, and also we have the origin and destination in them. Anything else?
So I have a comment as well as potentially a question here in itself is, my comment is that it's amazing to me as to, I guess I'm amazed as to how long it's taken to do this. At the same time, amazed as how short it's taken to do this is that it's incredibly complex transition from the four-step model that PSRC has always generated, supported through the years, and has developed this. And it's pretty amazing based, and that's amazingly short, and that this model comes at such an appropriate time where I guess we're looking for so much more from the region in terms of having more of a multimodal existence style living in itself and planning standard. So the question, however, is, to what extent, this is for all of our data people, including Craig, I guess, is to what do you foresee in the transition from the four step to this model for jurisdictions in terms of depicting transportation, both current and future conditions, as they talk about their comprehensive plan? Do you see a learning curve here for everyone? And how are people negotiating this curve?
You want me to take that, Stefan?
Yeah, go ahead, Craig, and maybe I can fill in if, go ahead.
Sure. So they're definitely, like with any model development stuff, there is definitely a learning curve, Jesse. And I would say that even existed when we were updating or modifying trip-based models, right? You'd have a new version of stuff, people adjust. The biggest difference I see is as a regional entity, and Stefan was really talking about the activity-based component of the model, a lot of our jurisdictions, when you're doing your comprehensive plan work, you're really looking at the network and the assignment part of it. So when Stefan took you all through those kind of different steps, that network assignment stuff really isn't any different. It's the same, right?
Yeah.
And so some of it, and we have a lot of this where we have jurisdictions who want to get, in the end, the trip tables from PSRC out of our model system, so that they can then do their own assignment where they do a lot more detailed network stuff, and they may split zones and do other things. That's all actually a very similar workflow now with Soundcast as it was with the trip-based model. Even the differences between an activity-based model and a trip-based model in terms of computing resources, they're closer and closer and closer together with one another. The sizes they take, they're all big. They're all memory hogs. They, you know, require stronger computers. So honestly, we're not seeing huge differences there. Probably the biggest difference is learning to deal with inputs at the parcel level. And we've heard that a lot from jurisdictions is like, I want to do land use scenarios. I want to change the number of people or the number of jobs in a place. Do I need to change that at the parcel level? How do I do that? And Stefan and Bryce and the modeling team have been working a lot with our local jurisdictions and consultants to actually make tools to make that easier to do. And so I think that's probably one of the bigger differences, because we, as a regional entity, we don't do a whole bunch of land use scenarios, right? We have Vision 2050, that is our land use. So we're not looking to move people and jobs around all the time like you would necessarily do with your comp plan update. So, it's a long-winded way of saying, yeah, there's some learning to it for sure. A lot of modelers around a region, City of Bellevue is using an activity-based model now. Pierce County is actually working right now to transition to a version of, we call it PierceCast. I have that right. So they're basically building off a Soundcast, and Stefan and PSRC staff are helping the county staff do that. So we're definitely seeing our local consultants who are using the tools, developing those skills and reaching out to us to kind of learn how to use it. But now that the activity-based model has been used at PSRC, not just for one RTP, but now two RTP cycles, it's like we're really getting to the point where we're a lot more comfortable. We know how to use it. We know what the limitations are. And I think it'll make that transition for folks easier.
Wonderful. And everyone sees that question that Jerry Poore had asked regarding the truck truck model, I guess.
Yeah, and I was just going to offer up, or and Stefan could offer to it. So Jerry, Stefan did talk about the different components of our model, and his focus was on the activity-based side, so the household demand side. We have a freight component to our model for sure, and there's always talk and desires to improve that freight component of our model as we move forward and kind of learn from one another, but we definitely have a freight component of the model.
Yeah, thanks, Craig. Yeah, Suzanne linked a presentation in the chat to something about our freight model. So that's helpful.
Thanks so much. I'll catch up for the time I was away. Sorry about that.
Oh, nothing to be sorry. And if you have any questions, Jerry, just reach out to us. We're happy absolutely. To chat. Any other model related questions for Stefan?
I don't see them.
All right. So thank you, Stefan. The fourth and final topic we have on here is our household travel survey. Brian's going to talk about that with you. And Brian, I'll turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Craig. Can I just get an audio and video confirmation?
Audio is good. It says you're sharing. There you go. It popped up. So now I see your screen.
Great. All right. Well, thank you for having us, everybody. Good morning. I'm Brian Lee. Program manager in the data department for data solutions and research. And together with Suzanne Childress, we've been leading a group of analysts within our org to look at the Puget Sound Household Travel Survey. Let me just advance this. So I'm gonna, I do this every time, and actually I was at this venue in July, and so most of you have probably heard about what the survey is, but I still wanna make sure that we're all on the same page. So I'm gonna do the briefest of intro to make sure we're on the same page. We're gonna do some highlights of data from 2021 survey, and I really wanna acknowledge the group of staff, particularly Christy, Grant, Mary, and Megan, who did the bulk of the analysis with me and Suzanne and kind of carry out a huge chunk of the work. And then I'm gonna provide the latest update on the 2023 survey to which Stefan made some references about. So this is just reminding us about the long history of the Household Travel Survey. We're talking about the 2021 survey, which was part of a three-wave, six-year program. We transitioned into this more frequent snapshot in 2017, which allows us to do very timely analyses and monitoring of trends. We had envisioned being able to combine data sets together, which we are comfortably doing with 2017 and 2019 data. As you know, 2020 was when COVID-19 hit, and these frequent snapshots have been allowing us to make comparisons between what's going on in 2021 to those pre-pandemic days. So allowing us flexibility, we didn't foresee the pandemic happening, but having these surveys every 2 years allows us to be nimble in terms of monitoring trends and looking at really what's going on in terms of travel and activities throughout the entire region. I will give that update about the 2023 survey. We are moving towards a new program. This will be an 8-year, 4 waves of survey, starting with 2023, which has been planned and started. The other ones coming up are planned and they're contingent on budget availability, but we're foreseeing us doing this more frequent types of surveying into the future. This is actually something that I think we're one of the lead agencies around the country that started doing this. And we're starting to see other places, including the Twin Cities, the Bay Area, as well as the National Household Travel Survey, kind of following our lead, doing surveys every 2 years, kind of recognizing that given all the transportation data needs that we have, our history of doing it every 8 to 10 years was really not sufficient given how fast things are changing, given growth and all the different economic transportation land use conditions that are happening. If you want to know more about our survey, the website link is down here. And as I posted on the chat earlier, all of our presentations are on the RSC webpage. So just very quickly about the goals of these multi-year program, and is essentially it's very simple. The surveys, they capture regionally representative data for all activity and travel behaviors of residents on a typical weekday. And we get a lot of questions trying to unpack basically this relatively simple goal. And I'm gonna make some references to Stefan's presentation, because at the end of the day, we want to make sure that we have data to support our modeling efforts, which is part of the backbone of our planning work. And to do so, we need to have technically sound data using the state-of-the-art random sampling, ensuring that we have extensive representation of people and places from all throughout the region, and then making adequate statistical corrections by using data weighting, so that at the end of the day, the data that we have is truly representative of the region. Stefan also mentioned that roughly 80% or so of the travel in our region are performed by these household demands by our residents. So this survey is a critical part of that. I'll note that because we are focused on residents, other things that may be of interest, including travelers, visitors, these are external trips from outside of our region or trips that are passing through the region, as well as commercial activities are not captured within this survey, but there might be other data sets that will help us with those pieces. And then lastly, traditionally, we are looking at weekdays, and we have been doing this in 2017 and 2019 survey, where we are sampling Monday through Thursday. As you know, the world that we live in, there might be variations, more variations than before on weekdays. So in the 2023 survey, we're gonna re-examine this, basically this priorities, to see if we need to do more data collection throughout the weekdays, as well as considerations of sampling in the weekend. There is definitely more of this background material. I was actually with you all in January, so I'm pointing you specifically to the January presentation for a lot more of the background on this survey program. I think Ben in the beginning mentioned that your last get together was in July. You were able to take the summer off. Our surveying group did not. We were actually quite busy. And we mentioned that we had planned to visit all of our transportation committees with specific analysis of the data to present at these committees. I'm happy to report that we were able to make it through all six of those committees. In the version of the presentation that's available online through the RSC website, you will be able to click through all these links if you're interested in these different topics. This current presentation kind of serves as a guide to many of the analyses that we've done. In fact, it's too much for us to cover at this one session, but what I will do is consider this our data season finale for the household travel survey. I will pick some highlights from these different presentations and hopefully pique your interest so that you might want to look at these individual ones. And so here are some topics that I've chosen for these highlights. A very often talked about topic is work location, which really relates to working from home and how that's been changing as far as commute travel demands. The mode shares as it looked in 2021, how that compares in previous years. Some non-motorized information on walk frequency, and then rounding it out with a trip purpose and a favorite of many questions that we get on home deliveries and services and how that's changed since the pandemic started. Just very quickly, I want to provide one indicator of the macroeconomic context for the survey and the period of time that we were in. The 2021 survey happened between April and June. So a full year since the pandemic lockdown. And these numbers shown on this graph is on covered employment in the entire region. We have the high watermark here just before the lockdown, close to 2.15 million jobs in the region. And that dropped dramatically because of the lockdown in the months afterwards, down to around 1.9 million. You see this kind of slow recovery that we're still on through 2020. And then in the period in 2021, the employment level was rising, but it remains approximately 100,000 below the March level. And that's just to kind of ground us in when I talk about during the pandemic or during the 2021 year, we're not necessarily talking about the 2020 period when things were much, much different than they were before the lockdowns, but they were also very different than during the survey period. So this is a snapshot during the spring of 2021. So moving on to the very first topic on work location. This is actually a slide that I had showed to you all in July, and I wanted to kind of start here to kind of ground us in looking at what work life was like. In each of these slides coming up, there are boxes at the very top that kind of references where you may be able to find more information. So again, if you have the presentation, the PDF version, the links there will take you to those individual presentations where we have a lot more analyses that will kind of look at additional things like by gender, industry, race and ethnicity, et cetera. In the 2021 survey, we asked workers about their work location for two periods. We asked them about it during the time they responded, which was spring 2021, but we also asked them what they did before March 2020. This allowed us to kind of gauge the change that happened between that period when the COVID pandemic policies became in place. There were a number of choices ranging from people who work outside of the home in one work location, like many of us who are on the call are likely in this category before March 2020. People who have multiple job sites, this could be construction workers, this could be a variety of people who have multiple offices or just have different places to go to. People who drive for a living, as well as, this is new, some form of hybrid. So this fourth choice is teleworking some days, but traveling to a work location outside of the home some other days. And then lastly, working from home only. So these are people who are either self-employed at home or telework fully. And what we saw was, as you expect, a big jump in teleworkers. When we combined these two last groups together of people who do at least some form of telework, the jump was from 16% to more than a third in this short period of time. This actually corresponds pretty well with a variety of national data. You kind of have to be careful when you're looking at national data, depending on people's definition of that. So I'll talk about that in the next slides. One thing that we do want to emphasize is that despite this jump, most workers, about 63%, almost two thirds, worked exclusively outside of the home. So those are these three categories out here. And then if you also consider this category of people that work at home sometimes and then go to a work location some other days, we definitely still have the vast majority of workers who are leaving their home for a work purpose. Now, Eric had mentioned the 2021 ACS. So since we came to you in July, this set of data came out, and the Census Bureau does ask a question about how people usually, these are workers, how they usually get to work. And the choices include different modes as well as work from home, but they only allow one option to be selected. So the key here is how people interpret usually. The way that I see this is that workers who telecommute maybe once or twice a week, not their usual thing, if they do a 5 week work week, then they would most likely be excluded. So previously in our household travel survey, where we have a broader definition, we reported 37% in 2021 who teleworked. From the ACS data, which is a narrower definition for our region, we're looking at around 30%. I pulled up the numbers for the different counties to kind of show you the unevenness of how teleworking is. And these are residents of these different counties. It ranges from a high in King County of 38% to peers on the other end of the spectrum, roughly 16% of the residents. And then looking even more deeply at this unevenness of geography for telework, we pulled up a bunch of data for cities that are over 65,000 people in our region. I think Eric mentioned that 1 year data is only available for places that are bigger than 65,000. That's the reason why we have this list. And you could really see the unevenness of this throughout our region. Redmond at the very, very top had more than half of their residents working from home in 2021. On the other end of the spectrum, you have places like Kent, Everett, and Marysville that are in the teens. So while it's interesting for us to kind of talk about a lot of the regional numbers, we do recognize that sometimes the regional numbers do mask some of these differences within our region. So that was about work location. I'm going to jump into mode shares, and you're going to see this quite a bit for some of the slides in those presentations that I referred to, as well as in these slides. Where it's useful and possible, we do combine 2017 and 2019 data to kind of just simplify the graphics. And we do this when there's really not big differences between those 2 years and we feel comfortable and confident in combining the data. What we wanted to highlight here is that mode shares, which is something that is very often used and talked about in transportation planning, and really the difference that the pandemic has made. Now, I can certainly zoom in and kind of tell you that some of these differences are kind of hard to see, but what I can tell you in this graph is that driving and transit had decreases, walking has an increase, but all of the changes for mode shares at the regional level were relatively modest. It takes a lot to move the needle on mode share, and that's something that we like to remind people when we're talking about mode share. A caveat, of course, is that the amount of travel. We know that in 2020, the amount of travel drastically decreased. In 2021, things were picking up. They were not necessarily all at the same level as they were before the pandemic. And this was particularly true, and it's still true for transit in general. So when we talk about shares in the 2021 numbers, these are going to be shares of a set of trips in the region that is different than what it was previously. Diving into one specific type, looking into walk frequency, the survey asked people, in addition to the trips they made, how they make them, and we could identify walk trips there, we also very specifically asked people whether they walked or biked in the last 30 days. And so what's important here is that we are still showing the two different years. The purple is 2021 and green is 2017 and 2019. It's useful to look at the people that said, I never do this, because it's basically everyone who didn't do some kind of walking regularly. And that was a dramatic decrease of people from 2017 and 2019 pre-pandemic to 2021. Noticeable change in certain types of frequencies, and there would be a cascading effect. You know, some people who never do this would do it maybe once or twice or a few times a week, and then increasing the frequency. But I think the most important takeaway message is that this kind of decrease in people who said they never do this meant that up to 85% of the people in our region did some kind of walking for either recreation or for utility purposes. And that in itself was a pretty significant finding. Next, I want to get into trip purpose. And this one, I'm kind of showing you some of the slicing that we do. I mentioned that by gender, by race. In this case, this was from our special needs transportation presentation that Suzanne did. And we looked at a variety of things for lower income households, older adults, and people of color. And this was kind of interesting to see, and perhaps in some ways intuitively, that people with different characteristics may exhibit different travel behavior. We asked for trip purposes and we combined the analysis with the household income. And what we found was that for certain types of trips, like shopping trips, interestingly, folks that are living in households under $50,000 per year of income basically made one third of all of their trips for shopping purposes. And that compares to only roughly about one quarter of the trips for higher income household. On the other hand, for work and school purposes, the lower income category exhibited less travel than for higher income. And at least for the shopping reason, we might postulate reasons that there might be differences in people substituting their actual trip making with things like deliveries of groceries or other types of home services. And that really leads me to the last data slide that I'm going to show you. This is a series of questions that we started asking in 2017 about the types of home deliveries and services that people had to their home. And this was our way to really look at not travel that were made by residents, but these are travel that were induced, caused by residents. So it allows us to get a little bit at the types of freight and freight-related traffic that are induced by people living in our region. As you can see, this one, I separated them out, the data out from 2017, 2019, and 2021, because this is something where there were changes between those two pre-pandemic years. And some of those changes accelerated, as you may expect. The four categories of things include food and meals. So this is like your pizza delivery or DoorDash. Things are delivered to your door ready to eat. Groceries are from stores like Costco, Safeway, or people using Instacart services. Packages are anything that's delivered by USPS as a package or FedEx or UPS or other types of services. The last one, this category of work service, are essentially people who come to your home to do work like landscaping, house cleaning, activities like that. Interestingly enough, maybe not surprising, work service is the only one that stayed relatively stable. We've all heard about labor shortages, being unable to get people to do stuff at home. So there's a constraint there in terms of the supply. But for the other three types of deliveries, we really saw increases. And one thing I should note is that these are shares of households that got something delivered to their home in one of these categories on an average weekday. So these numbers for food and meal and grocery may seem small, but you wouldn't necessarily expect everyone to be getting grocery deliveries every single day. So when grocery deliveries is at 5%, and we when we presented this at the freight committee, we kind of got some confirmation from the committee members who have looked at other data sources that this resonates with the other data sources. This is actually a relatively significant amount if you think about how often you yourself and others may be getting groceries delivered. And of course, the show's stealer here in this chart is really the packages. The significant increase from roughly 20% of households in our region. So that was one in five households on an average weekday got a package delivered to them in 2017. that jumped in 2021 almost doubled to close to 40% in 2021. So this is a significant amount of increases, and you can imagine all the different impacts on our transportation system. We heard from a research group from Carnegie Mellon University who use our travel survey data, specifically this question, to model the impact of deliveries on congestions using data from the Seattle network just for the city of Seattle. And it was really interesting to see how our data is able to support the types of research that I hope to be eventually folding into some of the planning tools that we'll have. So looking towards the future, I present to you the very last slide, which is a timeline that I first showed you in January and then in July. We're slowly checking things off. We actually have our kickoff for the 2023 Household Travel Survey next Monday. We have two partners with us, the City of Seattle and the City of Bellevue. Both are contributing funds for add-on for extra data collection in their jurisdictions. We will work together on this project to collect data in the spring in 2023. We will start our process in terms of cleaning and weighting and all of the post-processing that we do to make this data reliable and usable. And we will have a new round of data by the winter quarter, the first quarter of 2024. So I know that was a lot. Please do check out the slides if you want any kind of information to the other presentations. Suzanne and I are both online, as well as others that were part of the analysis group. If there are questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them now or later.
Does anyone have any questions? I don't see anything in the chat thus far. As maybe people are contemplating questions, that's a great presentation. I think you remind us, Brian, also this is obviously not the first time you've presented on this issue to the various committees, boards, and themselves, and that this is an evolving type of effort itself. What do you folks see as being, how would people use this data? I mean, certainly this is survey data, as they develop their own comp plans and the transportation elements overall. Do you think that there is tangible value in delving into the data, as these are survey samples for the most part, right?
So these are samples, just right, like the American Community Survey. And so we have very good confidence in the data that we've shown for at the regional level. We've also done some analyses at the county levels. And even for bigger jurisdictions, like in previous years when the City of Seattle had add-ons, not for 2021, but the other years, depending on the questions, it is possible to dive in a little bit more. I'll say that what's really useful about this data is that it grounds us to our region. And even if it's not specific to your jurisdiction, it provides very often a useful context. We do a lot of analyses by different socio-demographic dimensions like race and ethnicity, by gender, just to look at things through the equity lens. And again, things might be specifically different in your jurisdiction, but it does provide that context of what's going on in your county and perhaps what's going on at a higher level at the region.
Excellent. Jonathan?
Yeah, thanks. That's really interesting. My question is, do you think that on the, you'll see a general reduction in shopping trips by households and increase in package delivery? Is that, do you think that's resulting in an overall increase in BMT for the region or decrease?
That's a really good question. And I'm actually gonna punt on it because we've been thinking about this quite a bit. One of the problems with the previous years of data is that we don't have adequate information for the weekends. And we know that shopping trips happen throughout the entire week. So yeah, people might get deliveries on an average weekdays. Does that really mean that they don't go to the stores? Maybe it makes a difference in some of the days that we're able to observe, but we don't know what's going on the weekends when we know that shopping trips tend to peak. So that's one of the consideration. And really no one can answer that question really well, unfortunately.
Maybe
I don't mind going out on a limb and actually saying that I think it preliminary looks at it for an average weekday, it doesn't really look like it. The number of shopping trips are going down for high income households. That's what it looks like to me. This is a preliminary going out on a limb. This is unscientific. It looks like it's probably increasing VMT.
I think my instinct would be it's increasing VMT, but I think my question is in part the delivery services, it's all trip chained, you know, and they use really efficient algorithms to deliver this stuff. So does that, you know, is it more efficient for them to deliver all this stuff in 8 different packages or me to go to Target and get it all at once? You know what I mean? Like, yes. That's the kind of stuff that is really complicated and I think the next kind of logical question for us as policy folks is, should we be trying to push down on this, on individual package delivery at the household level? So that's really where I'm headed. So yeah, thanks.
Jonathan, that's a great question. And I think I'm going to point you, since you're from SDOT, I'm going to point you directly to the Carnegie Mellon folks, because it's not that simple. They've actually been able to kind of test out different scenarios of whether people all aggregate. Like, imagine if grocery shopping, there's only one single player and everything is efficiently coordinated versus people who make their own trips. And it also depends on whether the trips are coming from their local grocery stores that they would have went to or some central warehouse. So there's a whole bunch of variability, and really there are some sweet spots, so to speak, but we're not there as far as research to really help answer that question in a simple way. But it's great that there is research going in that direction to help us kind of think about, in the context of where we are, there might be some fairly dominant players and the way that habits are changing. One of the critiques that we had provided to the researchers is that, so what if the shopping trips are replaced? Do people necessarily not go shopping and then sit at home? Chances are very good that they might consider making other trips, like social trips or doing other things in their time. So when we're talking about overall VMT, and you need to kind of think about the substitution of that specific purpose, but also across the different activities that people do and how people actually spend their time. So from a time spent activity perspective, it's a very, very complex question. And I'm so glad you brought it up.
Awesome. It'd be great also, Brian, as I won't be around when this happens, but the next time you're looking to solicit funds for local jurisdictions for additional surveys, please let us know. We know that it's available to us, but we also tend to forget. I have forgotten as to when to do that, but of course it's fairly expensive at $200 per survey, right? So it's something that I believe is worthwhile, but jurisdictions probably should consider if they want to increase their levels of confidence in the surveys themselves, as this is a sample. And we all know that it's very limited in terms of per jurisdiction every time you update them in themselves. Do I see other questions? I do not.
Jesse, just to call folks' attention, there was a question in the chat that Brian answered, and it had to do with the mode share question, and it was for all trips.
Okay, excellent. I didn't see that. Thank you. I believe that's it for our agenda today. Is that correct, Ben?
That is. Yes.
Awesome. My understanding is that the next meeting will be held Thursday, October 17th.
November.
November. Yeah, right. I'm going backwards.
Yeah.
And I want to echo again my thanks to the leadership here for Ben and Craig for hosting this particular event. Shout out to Stefan, Eric, Lauren, Brian, and Suzanne for their staffing this particular meeting as well. These were all excellent presentations. I know that the presentations were great in their complexity, but what's really good is that this transcript is available as a recording later on, and also that the presentations are available online as well. I suggest you go to them because it's easy to miss the information, and the hyperlinks are provided in them are very useful and valuable as well. So with that, I wish everyone, I guess this meeting closes out. I want to wish everyone a safe commute home, even if you're home. And also that even if you're home, be very careful because unfortunately Seattle is number one, not in baseball, but apparently in bad air quality at the moment. So wear your N95 mask if you're going to go bicycling, because that's what I did yesterday. And it was kind of hard to breathe and not cool. So nonetheless, you take care, everybody. Have a good day.
Thank you all. See you next month. And hope to see you at one of our upcoming events.